Hey, Internet. Gordon, I'm with PC World here. I'm with Dr. Seshu Madhavapeddi.
That's right.
Of the company, this is the hard part for me. He's going to correct me if I'm wrong. Of Fror. I just can't do it. The dry CES environment has got to my throat.
It's Fror Systems.
Fror Systems.
Yeah.
And I will say, at CES, among the thousands of vendors, this might be one of the coolest things I've seen here, and that is Airjet. We actually wrote about this on PC World. You can go read a story written by my coworker, Mark Hockman, in words, but it's better to hear it from the horse's mouth. And this, he was instrumental in creating it. We're gonna talk about Airjet. What is this for the viewer from the internet? What does this do exactly?
Well, we are a Silicon Valley startup that's 4 years old. And we set out to create the world's first solid state active cooling chip. So when you look at thermal in any compute device, typically, active cooling is done using fans. If you have a fan, you got active cooling. Or if you don't have a fan, then you're limited to passive cooling, which is actually a much lower thermal level. And the type of thermal cooling you have in a device essentially dictates the performance you're going to get on that device. Your processor could be very high caliber,
right.
But if your thermal design is not good, then
right.
You would only get 50%, in some cases even only 25% of the total performance as the processor is actually capable of. So this has been a big problem in computing
right.
for many years now. And so we asked the question, why do you have to depend on 100-year-old fan technology to cool these 21st century devices?
Okay.
Why can't we create a chip? So it's taken us 4 years, but now we've got this ready. This is the Airjet.
Airjet Mini, right? This is the Mini
version? This is the Mini. And this is the world's first solid-state active cooling chip.
You know, when people hear solid-state, they're like, well, what is in there? So like, this basically replaces a fan.
That's right.
And you're sucking the air, you're moving air somehow. What is the magic that you make this chip out of?
Well, this chip is, 2.8 millimeters in thickness. But there's a lot of complexity that goes inside this chip. There's actually a cavity inside the chip in which we got vibrating membranes.
Okay.
These are MEMS membranes. And as they vibrate, they create this huge suction force, what we call back pressure, that pulls air through the holes at the top of the chip.
Okay.
And then that air is pushed down and it hits the copper heat spreader at very high velocities, up to 200 kilometers per hour of pulsating jets, we call them. And that is an excellent way of extracting heat because you're able to break through the so-called boundary layer. And so you're able to extract heat from this hot copper surface with high efficiency, and then the hot air exits sideways.
That's the exhaust.
At the exhaust of the chip.
So the boundary layer you're talking about, that is what it's like, this visible barrier, right?
Well, it's almost like a blanket of air molecules that are close to the hot surface. What they do is they prevent flowing air from being able to pick up heat efficiently. So let's say you're using a blower or a fan.
Okay.
And as the air goes through the fin stack, it picks up heat, but it doesn't get saturated with heat. Because as the air is passing through the fin stack in a fan case, it's able to pick up maybe 25 to 30% of its total heat capacity. But if you want to make it 100% saturated with heat, then you got to break through the boundary layer. And the pulsating jets that we create inside this chip allow us to do that.
And that's because you just have that velocity. 200, I'm an American, so I'm not sure what 200 kilometers per hour is, but that's a lot.
Yeah, it's like 120 miles an hour.
Okay, that's pretty good.
And it's hitting vertically. It's got to be very high frequency, high velocity, and it also has to hit vertically on the hot surface to break through the boundary layer. And it's a technique in thermal heat transfer called jet impingement.
Okay. So I think visually, though, what's kind of cool is, so this Airjet Mini actually has the same back pressure, which is that pressure that you're blowing down as this, right?
That's correct. One of the huge selling points of our chip is the high back pressure. And this has 1,750 pascals of back pressure that it creates, which if you were to use a fan, you'd need something like this to generate the same amount of back pressure. Now, back pressure is important because when you put a fan or an air jet inside a super thin device, you got a very constrained channel through which you need to move the air.
Right.
And as you make the channel more and more constrained, there's more resistance to the airflow. And to overcome that air resistance, you need a lot of back pressure. So very often, if you use, let's say, a typical blower that goes into notebooks, something like this, this only has about 195 pascals of back pressure compared to 1750. So it's like a tenth of what we got.
Right.
And what happens is, even though this can generate a lot of flow in outside, when you actually put it inside a notebook, the amount of flow it generates drops like a rock.
Yeah, and then...
And in our case, you will see no difference in the airflow, even when it's inside a notebook. Moreover, with 1750 pascals of back pressure, we can actually make the notebook dustproof. So you can actually cover the vents with dustproof IP68 air filter material, and that doesn't prevent us from being able to generate an airflow.
And why can't I do that with just a normal fan that we're seeing here?
Because it has very low back pressure, and the amount of suction force it has cannot overcome the resistance that's created by the dust guard.
So basically, this is really, really powerful. I mean, we have a video here. You can see this thing actually blowing a ball around. So it's kind of amazing. And all it is the membranes vibrating. And
that's correct. And we use semiconductor technology and manufacturing techniques to manufacture this chip. So as a result, we're putting thermal for the first time on the innovation curve that you're familiar with in semiconductors. So you will be able to see more powerful chips coming from us in subsequent generations.
Okay, so this is just first generation.
That's right.
And you, sir, it could get more powerful then.
It will get more powerful.
So, okay, I think that's pretty cool because, you know, right now the application to me seems like for Ultrabooks, this is kind of cool because you can dustproof it.
It's silent operation.
That's the thing that gets me because I review a lot of really thin laptops. They're getting very powerful and they have to basically, they can't increase the size of them. So they put more fans in them or they crank the fan speeds up.
That's right. Either you go without fans, in which case you have low performance.
Right.
Or you put fans in and it gets really noisy. And it's, it allows dust to go in as well. So with this, you can make it silent and dust resistant, and at the same time deliver much higher performance than you can using fans.
Okay.
So we've got several instances where we are able to show that in an ultra-thin notebook, you would usually have like a 10-watt thermal limit if it did not have a fan.
Right.
Putting in a fan would bring it up to 15 watts, but very noisy. Putting AirJet, you can actually move it to 20 watts CPU power. Operating in silence and in a dustproof manner.
So that sounds really good. Mike, the other question though is like, so it takes power to run a fan, of course, but this also takes power. How does that work out with your power budget? Is it gonna?
This takes a 1 watt of power to operate, maximum of 1 watt. It can also operate at lower power levels, and it can remove 5 watts of heat, each chip. And we also got a pro version, which is twice as powerful, so this can remove 10 watts of heat.
Okay.
So our philosophy is that, you know, with this chip, you are essentially moving thermal into scalable solution, much like memory in a computer. So, you know, if you want to have 8 GB, you might have one DRAM chip. If you want 16, you add another. Go to 32, you add a couple of more. So likewise, depending on how much of thermal performance you want in your notebook, you can add multiple of these chips. So it's plug and play. So our vision is, you know, look at notebooks today. If you want a gaming notebook, for example, you got to lug around a very heavy, thick notebook.
Yes.
Why can't a gaming notebook be just as thin as a MacBook Air? Well, our vision is to deliver powerful chips for active cooling that will make that possible.
Okay, right now though, we're gonna probably see it. I mean, it sounds like the application right now is more in ultrabooks, right? I mean, the ultrabooks and phones or?
Ultra thin notebooks, you know, we can match up to 28 watts of CPU power, which is actually the TDP for most Intel chips. So we can design ultra thin notebooks that can go up to 28 watts of performance and not limited to the 10 watts that they're currently at, and do it silently.
To me, that's the thing is gaming laptops have gotten really powerful and actually really thin and also extremely loud. So I kind of look forward to this. Do you have to just basically, are you going to have to use larger versions of this? Is that in the future, or could we do this with the existing large and small versions?
We're not quite ready for gaming laptops yet, because you need to be in the order of not 28 watts, but 100 watts of heat removal. So we will look to being able to address that in a future generation of products as we make these chips more powerful.
Okay.
But that's our vision, that ultimately there should be no correlation between thermal performance and the thickness and the weight and the noise that a computer platform generates when it's using fan technology for cooling.
Yeah. So I had a question. So the demo that you have on a laptop showing the Airjet modified to keep the CPU coolers pretty neat. But I noticed the way it was done was it instead of being on the CPU itself, it was actually attached to a conventional heat pipe. What's the advantage of connecting it to a heat pipe instead of just going right on the CPU die?
Well, you can if you go right on the CPU die, you're increasing the Z height, and when you want to make the laptop really thin, our customers prefer to keep our AirJet chips beside the processor and not on top of it. And when you put it beside the processor, you still have to have a means of conducting the heat from the processor to the chips, and we recommend that they do that with a very thin vapor chamber.
Okay. Do you think that it would be, but the performance, if you were seeking the ultimate performance, you would just get thicker. Going direct attach is still better than having an intermediary, right?
Well, actually, vapor chambers are very efficient.
Oh.
So there is no loss in the temperature when you use a vapor chamber. It's a superconductor.
Oh, okay.
It's a great little thing where basically you have two pieces of copper with some water vapor in between, and it's very efficient for transferring heat. And so it works very well and allows you to make devices that are really thin.
Yeah, because then my other question is like, well, currently vapor chambers are used in a lot of laptops. I've seen very large ones sometimes. But couldn't you just at some point have the Airjet Maxi and you've got this, couldn't you replace an entire vapor chamber with a gigantic Airjet, or that just doesn't make sense?
Well, I mean, usually the processor dies are very small.
Okay.
Typically it would be smaller than a mini. So, and since we're using a very thin layer of copper underneath, you want uniform spreading of heat in the copper. And in order to do that, it is still better to first connect a vapor chamber to the processor die and then place these multiple of these chips on the vapor chamber so that you get a uniform distribution of heat across the entire bottom surface of these chips.
Well, another good question is like that I have is like, is the cooling potential only concentrated in one area on it, or is it the whole bottom side?
The whole bottom side. So what the vibrating membranes are doing are creating these pulsating jets that are hitting this copper heat spreader
and
inside.
Shooting straight down?
Shooting straight down.
Okay.
All across the entire bottom surface, inside. We actually can show you a cross section, and when you see the cross section, you'll see how it's all operating.
Okay. Goes down and out, and
that's
then
right. Goes down and out, but goes down as pulsating jets at very high velocities, and using this technique of jet impingement, we're able to saturate the air with heat. So it's very high efficiency heat transfer.
Oh, okay.
This technique is actually used in cooling the jet engines.
Oh.
Yeah, aircrafts use that technique of jet impingement.
Earlier you mentioned that fans are 100 years old.
More than 100 years old.
More than 100 years old. Could we, looking to even more, this is way down the road, and I know people don't like to talk about future products, but graphics cards today, I don't know if you've seen them, have gotten as big as a loaf of bread practically. I'm wondering if there's any advantage, could the application down the road scale up to where you could actually cool a desktop card off more effectively?
We believe yes.
Okay.
We're just getting started. This
right.
is first generation.
Sure.
We're a four-year-old company. With a very ambitious outlook, so we'll keep executing steadily and getting better every year.
Okay, it's amazing. The technology is amazing. I see a lot of amazing technology demos. Really, like wow, you can see that this is great stuff. Is it going to work from a business sense though? Because a lot of people say, "Wow, that's really cool," but if it's going to cost 100, 180 times more than a fan, is it going to make business sense for this to make it?
Absolutely. It okay. does. And we're working with several device manufacturers, and you'll start seeing products in the market with our technology in it in the later half of 2023 this year. And it makes perfect business sense.
Okay. So we'll actually see the first products end of 2023. I forgot it's 2023. We'll see it at the end of this year, devices with this. I know you probably can't say what, but.
Unfortunately, I cannot. I have to let my customers make the announcements okay. on their own schedules. But yeah, we're working with several integrating this technology into their future okay. devices.
You know, and I do want to point this out because we have Gen 5 mm-hmm. SSDs coming out. And if you look quickly at this, you would think it's an SSD, right? Because I just want to encourage you to I would love to see this on a Gen 5 SSD because that's...
Yeah. It's 2.8 millimeters thick.
Yeah, because the coolers we are now seeing for SSDs are this tall, which is with, you know, passive.
Not surprising. You know, if you're using 19th century technology, that's what it's going to be.
Yeah. Okay, well, thanks for talking to me about this. And again, this is one of the coolest things I've seen at CES. So we look forward to seeing this in a product at the end of this year.
Thank you, Gordon.